And and who loves us beyond our needs. Amen. Dear friends, together let us acknowledge our failure to love this world as Jesus does. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that sin still has hold on us. We have harmed your good creation. We have failed to do justice, love, kindness, and walk humbly with you. Turn us in a new direction. Show us the path that leads to life. Be our refuge and strength on the journey. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and friend. Amen. Beloved of God, your sins are forgiven, and you are made whole. God points the way to new life in Christ, who meets us on the road. Journey now in God's abiding love through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We'll start now with the opening song.
Elisha sent a messenger to him saying, "Go,
Wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean. But Naaman became angry and went away saying, I thought that for me he would surely come out and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, and would wave his hand over the spot and cure the leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean? He turned away and went in a rage. But his servants approached and said to him, Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you not have done it? How much more when all he said to you was, wash and be clean? So he went down and immersed himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. His flesh was restored like the flesh of a young boy, and he was clean. Then he returned to the man of God, he and all his company. He came and stood before him and said, Now I know that there is no God in all the earth except in Israel. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from 2 Timothy. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, a descendant of David. That is my gospel, for which I suffer hardship, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But the word of God is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, so that they may also attain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is sure. If we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Remind them of this, and warn them before God, that they are to avoid wrangling over words, which does no good, but only ruins those who are listening. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved by him, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly explaining the word of truth, the word of the Lord.
I'd like to invite any children to come forward for the children's message. I have money. Just saying. Wow, nobody else wants to come up, huh? I guess she's going to get all the pennies. Eleanor? It is Eleanor, right? Yeah. All right. I'm going to give you, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 pennies. Okay? All right. I'm going to take 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. All right. So, have you ever had money before of your own? Okay. And what did you do with your money? You saved it. And where did you save it? Do you have a piggy bank at home? Kind of like my little piggy here? You have a wallet. Okay. So you put your money in your wallet and then you keep it in there. So when would you use the money? To buy a phone? What kind of phone? A 13 Pro. Yeah. With those 5 pennies. No? Why not? You have to have a lot of money and you have to save things, right? Yeah, that's what she said. Okay, so we only have 5 pennies. I wanted to, so we're beginning to talk about stewardship here in the church today. And so this is a special pig that has 3 names on it. Can you see what it says? Yep, share, save, and spend. And in this case, this is a piggy bank that's reminding you to share some, to save some, and to spend some. So tell me, what would you spend money on? We know about the phone. Anything else? Pretty shoes, of course, pretty shoes. And what would you save money for? A what? A limo? Okay, all right, so a limo. Sure, okay, why not? Okay, and then what do you think sharing is about? Give something to someone who's poor, she said. Yeah, absolutely. But what about the people in the church? Yeah? So how would you give people money in the church? Okay. Would you be willing to give them one of your pennies? Can you go do that right now? Can you go give anybody in the congregation just one penny? Okay. Very nice. Okay, so how many got left? Four. Would you be willing to give one more away? Okay, go give one to someone else. Go find someone. Okay, how many got left? Three. Now we only have three slots here. Okay, so would you be willing to give one more away? Okay, go give out another one. Okay, so how many got left? Two. Got three slots though here. So do you want to put one in here, or would you rather give one away again? You'd rather give it away. Okay, go give it away. Go give it to someone. Okay. So now you got one. Do you think you're going to still... Now, I'm going to ask you a tough question. You only have one left. There are three slots here. But the other choice is that you give it away again. Would you be willing to give your last penny away? Yeah? Okay, go give it to someone. That was very nice of you. Now how many have left? You don't have any left. What? You gave it all away? But you were supposed to share, save, and spend. What about the piggy bank, Mr. Piggy? You drew a few sacks because you gave all of his pennies away. But guess what? I have five more. Here you go. I'll give you these five, and then you can put it in one of the slots. How about that? But then you got to decide, because you have five pennies and you only have three slots. Okay. Save, save, save. She put it all in save. Smart girl. Well, you did already share, and you didn't spend anything yet, but if you save, then it becomes something that you spend, right? Did you know that we have a little bit of money here, too, in the church? Do you know what it's used for? Crafts and things, sure, yeah. And what else do you think the money pays for? Yeah, the building. We like having electricity, right? Air conditioning is nice, right? And anything else you think we spend money on here at the church?
Food,
water, sure. What about the community? Who pays for that? All of us. You almost said you. I know that. I heard that. I don't pay for that, but the people of this church do. And whenever somebody puts money in that plate, guess what it does? That's right, it helps the church. And so if we want to continue to grow as a church, what do we have to do? So it doesn't become like a disaster. You're right. And so we have to continue to support the church, right? Because you like having things in Sunday school, right? Sure we do. And we like having communion. And we like when we see things clean in the church. You know, Aaron does that for us. And so we have to pay Aaron to do that stuff. Yeah, because Aaron works hard around here. Let me tell you, he cleans everything around here. Even the toilets. That's right. Yeah, he cleans those things too. And so we have to and the way we do that is by sharing our pennies or our dollars and putting that into the plate. And so I want you to remember that, and I hope that in a couple weeks we have someone from private coming, and I might be able to give you one of these piggies. They're supposed to bring some for all the children of our church so that we can share these, and then you can have one of these at home. So hopefully when they come, I'll have one to give to you so that you can share, save, and spend. But we're going to talk more about stewardship over the next couple weeks, and I just wanted to share that with you first. But you know what? You were very generous today. Thank you for sharing your pennies. And for those of you that received those pennies, of course, you can keep them. I just wanted her to have that opportunity to do that. So let's pray about that before you go back to your seat, okay? Gracious and loving God, thank you for the many ways that you provide for our church. Thank you for the gift of children whose innocence reminds us of what we are called to do, to share with one another in, with, and through all things, so that your purpose for our church continues to thrive and grow in this place. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Eleanor, for coming up. And you can stay seated for the gospel today, because technically it's not a gospel, so I'm just going to read from the book of Ruth today. And you can follow along there in your bulletins. Since I have it up here. From the book of Ruth, the first chapter. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to live in the territory of Moab, and he and his wife and two sons. The name of the son was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. And they were Ephraimites and from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. Though these took Moabite wives, and the names of one was Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth. And when they had lived about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, so that the women were left without her two sons and her husband. Then she returned to her daughter-in-law from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab that the Lord had considered his people and given them food. So she set out from the place where she had been living, she and her two daughter-in-laws, and they went to go to on their way to go back to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughter-in-laws, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find security, each of you, in the house of your husband." Then she kissed them, and they wept loudly. They said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Do I still have sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. Even if I thought there was hope for me, even if I should have a husband tonight and bear sons, would you then wait until they were grown? Would you then refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, it has been far too more bitter for me than for you, because the hand of the Lord has turned against me." Then they wept aloud again. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. So she said, "See, your daughter-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not press me to leave you or to turn back from following you. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. There will I be buried. May the Lord do thus and so to me, and more as well, if even death parts from you." The word of the Lord.
Amen.
And please pray with me. Gracious and abundant God, we are thankful this day for the gift of relationships. And Lord, as we continue to discern our life-giving relationships, may the one most important to us, our relationship with you, continue to thrive and grow. And may the meditation of my heart and mind be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name I pray. group in its entirety. I hope that you do. And if you've never heard it before, I invite you to read the rest of the story. Naomi and Ruth have this long relationship together as she continues to journey to the land of Judah. And Naomi does eventually marry and ends up, of course, where is it Ruth that marries? Ruth marries. And then, sorry, I had it backwards. And then, of course, and they end up supporting each other in the land of Judah. And today, we are beginning our stewardship drive as we discern the gift of relationship. And to me, this story in Scripture is a good reminder of the gift of relationship and the importance of nurturing them. But I would commend to you that there are three levels of healthy relationships. There are casual friends, the ones that you see every once in a while, maybe once every 2 months or something, and you do have a connection with that individual, and whenever you're together, it's like you've never been apart, right? Those are your casual friendships. And then you have close friends. These are the ones that you hang around with on a weekly basis. They know a lot about you. You can trust this individual. And then there are those intimate friends. The intimate friends are the ones who know everything about you, good and bad. They can tell every story about you without you even having to say a word. And you know, and they also know the bad things too. So you don't want to make that person upset because they might go running to someone else and share something that maybe you don't want out there. But they're really, really close friends. And so these are the people that you truly trust. So as you know, Jesus, of course, had his own little circle of friends, the disciples, right? But Jesus also had a lot of other close, casual people who he saw occasionally as he was traveling through and doing his ministry. Those would be the casual friends, right? The disciples would have been considered the close friends. And then there are, I would say, Peter, James, and John, who were his intimate friends. The ones who went with him up to the mountain and the story of the transfiguration when he was transfigured, right? And so even Jesus, though, needed the support of friendship. And you might be saying to yourself, why is a relationship important? And what does that have to do with stewardship? Well, I would argue it has a lot to do. Why? Because we are called, of course, as the body of Christ to continue to uplift and support each other. And so I would argue that when we do that as the body of Christ, then we are also, we come to this place because we have like-minded friendships, maybe sitting next to you right now in the pew or across the aisle. And maybe you are passionate about MUST Ministries, or maybe you are passionate about helping our veterans in our community, and you know that so-and-so is also passionate about that particular ministry, and so you support that ministry together. Why? Because you trust your friend. You trust the relationships that you have built, and you discern, sometimes that helps us discern, what we put in the plate. Now, often, I once heard this saying that has often stuck with me. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. I'm going to say that again. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And when you care for another individual, either in our community or across the aisle, to another friend in this community, then we possess an attitude of gratitude. And when we possess an attitude of gratitude, then we naturally support that by giving when it's appropriate. Right? And so, think about stewardship in this particular story is that Naomi and Ruth are traveling to a foreign land for all expect, you know, if you think about the situation, they were traveling without men. First of all, that was unheard of during that time. Okay? Women could travel by themselves to provide food for them. When they arrived there, they were, so what they did back in those days is when they were harvesting the fields, the owners, the landowners, would often leave the scraps on the outside of the land itself, and that would be given to the poor. And so here is Ruth and Naomi. Now, Naomi, of course, being up there in age, she sends Ruth to go and go get some of that wheat that they left on the edge of the land there so that we can eat and prepare bread. And so that's what she does. And she goes, and they are living off the generosity of others in their community. Now, for us as disciples of Christ, there are many in our community who live on the supports of this congregation. There are many who rely on the food and the sustenance that bus ministry provides. There are many who provide and give to the veterans of this community. There are many who rely on the homes that Habitat for Humanity helps to build. And so when we support those ministries, we are, in essence, sharing a loving relationship with another individual. So, you might be saying, well, why is all that important? Because relationships matter. God himself walks into the garden seeking Adam and Eve after he had created them. Seeking them, he seeks them out, Scripture says. And then Jesus, always on the fringes of society, seeking the lost, the forsaken, the ones who were living off the land, the ones who were maybe condemned, the ones who were maybe abandoned by their own families, seeking them first to help and provide. Remember what happened on the Sermon on the Mount? I'm sorry, the feeding of the 5,000 story. How many loaves of fish were there? 5 loaves, 2 fish. How many people? Over 5,000. You know, it's actually, it says 5,000, but that doesn't include children and women, most likely. They were only counting the men. So we're going to probably say that that was probably closer to about 10,000 people. Okay? 5 loaves, 2 fish. Jesus doesn't say, send them away. What did he tell the disciples to do? Tell them to sit down. You feed them. That's the responsibility that we have as a congregation. Not to feed everyone in our community, of course, but to help those who cannot, for whatever reason, get out of their situations and need help. And that starts with relationship. That starts with the relationships that we have developed with these organizations as a church. But it certainly is strengthened by the relationships that we build as the body of Christ in this place. And so relationships matter. And when we possess an attitude of gratitude, then it becomes something that is natural. Giving is just becomes a natural extension of who we are. It becomes something that we do that out of, I want to say habit, but that's not the right word. It becomes something that we naturally do because it's the right thing to do. How about that? And when we are willing to give ourselves away, like little Eleanor did this morning, she had a choice. She could have chosen to keep those pennies all for herself. She could have chosen to put them all in that little safe thing, which she eventually did, but she shared first. And that's what we are called to do. Now look, I get it. Not everyone in this congregation has the resources to provide the financial support that we all need. In relationships, help us to be mindful of our relationship with you. We especially give thanks today for the gift of marriage and pray for Courtney and Zachary Olson, who were married yesterday. Send your Holy Spirit to dwell in all relationships. Lord, hear us as we sing. Personal. Christ our Lord.
Thank you.